Hey, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the National Humanities Center Humanities in Class webinar series. Tonight's episode is titled A Trip Around the World of the Year 1000. And I'm very pleased to be joined by Professor Valerie Hansen. Professor Hansen is the Stanley Woodward Professor of History at Yale University. And today is January the 27th, 2022. My name is Andy Mink. I'm the Vice President of Education at the Center. And I can tell you now that my staff, Jira, Mike, and Meredith, are all thrilled that you're here as well. They wish you the best. They greet you. We want to welcome you to the program. In particular, as I look around the room, you know, this topic has proven to be very, very popular, and it's really inspirational to see so many of you from different parts of the country who have chosen to spend 90 minutes with us tonight. That includes our old friend Ricardo. I haven't seen him, Ricardo. I haven't seen you in a while. Ricardo's from Miami-Dade College in South Florida. Amy's joining us here from Hilton High School in Woodbridge, Virginia. There seems to be a lot of Virginia folks in the room tonight. That includes Jessica, Newport News, and we very much appreciate you being here. Kristen's here from the 61st Street Elementary School. Jennifer, great to see you again from Cottesmill High School, just outside of Charlotte, North Carolina. Another Jennifer from Orange Beach, Alabama. Joe from Guilford County, not so far to the west of me, here in Chapel Hill. And Bass, I'm really glad that you figured out the system. We welcome you. You're here from Tennessee. As always, we have a lot of folks from Los Angeles Unified. Carla, Andre, Kyle, and Javita, thank you for joining us on the early part of the afternoon out on the West Coast. National Humanities Center is located in Durham, North Carolina. And I can tell you one of the best parts of working at the center, being associated with its community, is being able to get to know and be friendly with and have just really provocative conversations with a wide variety of scholars and professionals who are doing just incredibly interesting work in the humanities, advancing our understandings of our identity. In some ways, when I walk through that door, it almost feels like a time machine. It does feel like you're able to witness periods of time that have long since expired. You're able to channel voices, sometimes marginalized and invisible, other times more obvious and need some nuance. You're able to project yourself through the arts, through literature, through primary source documents, through deep research and historical study to other parts of the world and the planet and the history of humankind that that we don't have available to us here in 2022. That includes Barbara. Barbara's currently a fellow at the center. I see her in the room tonight, professor from New York University, and I'm really pleased she was able to join us. But I can tell you that when you leave that door, it doesn't mean the time travel ends. Because again, producing this kind of humanistic inquiry, being able to craft and write and describe and research with evidence the accurate reflection of the ways that human beings interact, both in classic and contemporary scenarios, is something that you can take away. And I hope tonight, although we've sort of playfully called this a field trip and an adventure, and we're going to take a trip, I do hope that you find ways to connect this with your curriculum and that it informs the conversations that you have with your students. One of the things you might need to do that are the resources available along this topic and others from the past. Please do consider using the Humanities in Class Digital Library for free and open resources that will help you create a time machine in your own classroom. That does include the readings and the resources associated with tonight's session. You can find all of those in the Humanities in Class webinar series group. And once you go to the group and you identify the season, the year, you can then go to the associated subfolder and find not just the readings, but you can also find within a few days the recordings of the session if you'd like to use those somehow in your instruction. I do encourage you to take a look through the rest of our webinar series. I think, by my count, I think we have 14 left this season. And these four, at least, seem to very specifically address the global connections that I feel educators and students are constantly trying to make, ways to connect our experience and our history and our people and our literature with other places long ago and far away is something that you're very talented and skilled at bringing to your students. I would encourage you to consider signing up for these or any other session you see in the coming couple of months. Please share it with your colleagues and your peers, and we would welcome all of them to join the webinar series for the first time. Although it's January, almost February, it won't be that long before you start counting the professional development credit that you've been earning this year. Of course, each of our webinars earns 5 professional development credit hours. And when you get into those May and early June time period, and you realize that the webinar series is over, but you still need some meaningful, rigorous credit, I do encourage you to take a look at the online course catalog. We currently have 2 spring sessions that are available. You can sign up for these classes and over the course of 5 weeks, take 35 professional development hours of work. But we also recognize that five weeks is a long time to commit to something when you're not in the middle of the year. So this year, we will begin to adjust our programs a little bit to meet your needs. And in June and July, we'll be offering what we'll call summer sessions. These will be the exact same courses with all the same work and benefit, but they'll be condensed to a week long of asynchronous learning. So if you're pushing at the end, you've got only a week left before that June 15th deadline in Los Angeles Unified, you need some credits, then this is a great way to earn 35 professional hours. And I encourage you to take a look at that to see the offerings. I'd also like to take a moment to share with you 2 summer on-site opportunities for educators. In both cases, we'll be welcoming a application pool and select teacher cohort from all over the country who will come to North Carolina and work at the center with scholars around these compelling topics. The first one is a 2-week institute in late July. This is titled Contested Territory, America's Involvement in Southeast Asia, 1945 to 75. You will receive a $2,200 stipend for attending, and applications are due by March the 25th. I hope that you consider applying. The application isn't burdensome, but it does require you to put together some documents, and we would love to have you join us. I'm also thrilled to announce that we will be offering an annual institute on the teaching of social justice, race, and place. In partnership with Prairie View A&M University in Houston, Texas, we'll be soliciting applications from K-12 teachers from around the country. We will be offering a stipend of $1,500, and we'll be covering all the travel costs. So this is really a remarkable way to come to the center and immerse yourself in that kind of scholarly work. One of the ways that we can support these kinds of programs is through very authentic and very mutual partnerships with different organizations that contribute to the digital library and work in the same field as we do. I'm really pleased tonight to welcome Brenda Randolph to tonight's webinar and invite Brenda to share with us a little bit about the work they do at the Center for African Studies at Howard University. Hey, Brenda, can you hear me up there in Washington, D.C.?
I can. Can you hear me down there?
We certainly can. Thank you for joining us, and we welcome you sharing for a couple of moments more work about the good work you do at the Center for African Studies.
Well, good evening, everybody. And I'm Brenda Randolph, the Outreach Director at the Center for African Studies at Howard University, and that's a job that I share with Dr. Vanessa Oyugi. And...
There you go.
Uh-huh. I have 2 new web-based projects to share this evening. The Gold Road, which traces the movement of gold and other trade items north and south of the medieval kingdoms of Ghana, Mali, and Songhai. In addition to trade items, our interactive map provides information on ancient and medieval cities, historical figures, landscapes, and architecture. This is a work in progress. We welcome your use and feedback. Our other interactive map is Discover Africa in the World, which identifies people and places related to Africa beyond Africa. Most of the sites on the map are in the U.S., but we are slowly expanding beyond the U.S. as we identify Africa-related sites in other countries. We welcome you to join us and help us identify more sites. Literature on Africa is another major focus of our program. The Center partners with Africa Access, which is a nonprofit that I founded, to provide reviews of African studies, reviews by African studies scholars of K-12 books on Africa. When you go to the website, you can click on any of these covers to go to the review, and we have many, many more reviews, so you can use the search box on the website for books that are not pictured. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I just lost everything, so I can't see anything, but is my next slide up?
I just put it up for you.
Thank you, okay. In 1991, Africa Access and the Title VI Outreach Programs on Africa founded the Children's Africana Book Award, which is the first of the World Area Awards. If you don't know about them, please contact me and I'm happy to share information about all the awards. On the Howard site, you can explore 30 years of CABA winners and other books recommended by African studies scholars. And also this February, we are launching Read Africa Aloud, which features award-winning authors reading their books. And above you see Penda Jakite, who wrote I Lost My Tooth in Africa 14 years ago when she was only 15. The book has stood the test of time. And finally, next Thursday, February the 3rd, CABA winner Ikiwa Iri is our featured speaker at Global Reads webinar. She will discuss the writing and production of her book, Idia of the Benin Kingdom, a picture book which introduces a real-life queen whose son ruled Benin from 1504 to 1550 in what is now Nigeria. And as I have learned over the years, picture books are not just for kids. So please tune in next Thursday and dive into history with this fascinating author. And thank you.
Professor, thank you so much for sharing your work with us and for being a good partner with our Humanities in Class Digital Library. As I mentioned, many of the resources from the African Center are located in the HICDL. Thank you, Brenda. So as we begin our program tonight, I want to remind you that it is an audio-only webinar, and if you have any kind of technical problems, there usually seems to be one of two easy solutions you can do on your end. Number one, you can play around with the volume button, which is located under the picture of me at this point. And the second thing you can do is log out and come back in. And if you do that, it will not disrupt the session and it will not disrupt your level of attendance. So please do find some ways to troubleshoot if you need to. I'd also like you to be sure to be as active and conversational as you can be in the audience chat box. But if you have a formal question for Professor Hansen, submit that in the Ask the Professor tab. And as the moderator, I'll bring this forward. Again, you have signed up for and are now registered and attending the Humanities in Class webinar titled A Trip Around the World of the Year 1000. I'm very pleased to be joined by Valerie Hansen. She's the Stanley Woodward Professor of History at Yale University. Tonight's TA is Myla Lidjemark. Myla is a social studies teacher in Seward, Alaska. Myla put together some instructional resources you'll find in the subfolder, and she'll be in the chat box sharing those links specifically. Professor Hansen, thank you for joining us. Can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you perfectly.
Thank you for joining us and agreeing to take us on this field trip, this time travel, as it were. You may have noticed at the beginning of tonight's session, I asked our audience to share what they would be most excited about seeing or experiencing in the year 1000 and what they would miss the most. But I'm curious from your perspective, what would you be most interested in seeing in person if we could somehow teleport you back to the year 1000?
Oh, for me, that's easy because it's related to what I'm working on now. I'd love to be on a ship. A Chinese ship going towards the Middle East or a Middle Eastern ship going towards China. The year 1000 would suit me fine. And I'd be very interested to see the technology of the ship. We have some ideas about Chinese ships and some ideas about Arabian ships. Less knowledge about the ships in between, the cargo, the crew. I suspect the crew would be international, the people from different places. And I'd just love to see how much stuff there is on the ships. There's been an archaeological site where a shipwreck that produced just under 600,000 Chinese ceramics from 970. So, I would just like to know, is that a question I don't think we'll ever know the answer to. Was that a typical ship or was that a super enormous ship? Anyway, that's what I would like.
That's a fantastic answer. Thank you for sharing that. And I appreciate that you came up with that very quickly and easily. And I think as we move through the session tonight, I'm hopeful that your descriptions will illustrate these same kinds of curiosities and our audience starts to change perhaps their own answers that they shared with us at the beginning. Professor, we're anxious. We've got the buddy system in place. We've got our backpacks. We're prepared to go. I'm going to hand you the wheel to the PowerPoint, and we're looking forward to your insights.
Thank you so much. And I'd like to thank everybody for coming out in the evening after a day of teaching, right? You must be exhausted. I'm very pleased to be speaking. You can see my title tonight, Around the World in the Year 1000. I fooled around for a long time with around the world and, you know, how many days. And at the end of the lecture, you will find out, using the transportation available to us in the year 1000, about how long this trip might take. And just a couple of things I'd like you to think about before we start. One is, what kinds of transportation were available? And the answer to that is, really, there was no mechanized transport of any kind. So people were walking. Often we know that they were walking huge distances. They were traveling in carts. Sometimes they were on horseback. The carts were often pulled by mules. Sometimes they were riding camels. In terms of traveling, we know that merchants were traveling, explorers. I think there's a thin line between explorers and merchants, people going to a new place, seeing if they could, there were trade opportunities of any type. Often on the first trips, they would trade literally what they were wearing. But not all the travel was voluntary. There is a huge slave trade already at this time. I'll be talking about that. There are some parts of the world that I won't be talking about tonight. The best example is Australia, also the sub-Saharan Africa, for the most part, is we don't know much about, and Latin America, I would say south of Peru, south and east of Peru, we don't know that much about. But the rest of the world is starting to have connections, really for the first time that we can say that so much of the world is interconnected. And that's why my book claims that, or I make the claim that globalization begins in the year 1000. And the trip has five legs, so my talk has five parts. And the final two legs are much less certain. There's much less evidence about them than the first three. Before we start, just a quick snapshot of the world's population. Given all of our concerns today about too many people on the planet, it's, I think, kind of fun to think about the world in 1000, when probably there were about 250 million people. You can see the biggest slice of the pie is on the right. The gray is Asia. And China would take up two-thirds of that slice of the pie. And then both Europe and Africa probably held about 20% of the population, 10% in the Americas. And then the very, very thin piece of pie would be the Oceania. So we'll start here. And our trip, we're going to be, now is my cursor visible to you?
There? Unfortunately, your cursor is not, so you'll have to use, you'll have to describe that and illustrate it.
Okay. So anyway, we're traveling from China, which is the yellow, bright yellow, and from one of the ports on the southeast coast of China, and we're traveling by water because that's the fastest and easiest mode of transport. There are risks of storms and being shipwrecked, and there's some piracy, but it's much less arduous than traveling overland. So we're traveling from China, and we'll make our way around Southeast Asia and South Asia and go to the main port by Baghdad, and which on this map is next to the green, there's a green blob, that's the modern day Afghanistan, and just to the west of that is the Buyid Kingdom, and that was where Baghdad was. I'll show you some more maps later. So here's a map of China, of the Song Empire. And this was the Song Dynasty was ruling China in the year 1000. And the capital was in Kaifeng. And you can see Quanzhou is it's Quanzhou. The name of the city is floating in the ocean. And it's on its face is Taiwan. It's and Guangzhou, the old English name for Guangzhou is Canton. Those were the two major ports in the Song Dynasty. And I wanted to give you a visual sense of what Chinese cities looked like at this time. And I think the best way to do that is to look at this painting called the Qingming Scroll. It's often referred to as China's Mona Lisa, not because it's like the Mona Lisa painting, not at all, not a portrait of a person, but it's as famous in China as the Mona Lisa. There are many copies. If you have been to China or you go to China, at some point you'll probably stay in a hotel where this painting is behind the desk you check in to the hotel. And it presents a cityscape. I think it's an imaginary cityscape, but other people think it's the capital of the Song in Kaifeng. And it presents a cityscape, and it was painted, we know for sure, sometime before 1186, and recent research suggests it may have been painted around 1000. And if we zero in on the bridge, these are black and white photographs, which are easier to see, especially in a PowerPoint presentation. But you can see on the bridge that there are a lot of stalls and little shops that are selling different things, many of them selling food. This would be true of a market in China today. But this shop here I've got the detail of, is a hardware store, and it's all kinds of different metal goods are for sale. And then I have a detail here showing you what Chinese scissors look like. And so this is one of the many pieces of metal that's for sale, is these scissors. And that's important to historians because metal production often tells us a lot about the society and its level of economic development. Here is a picture of an inn that is also in the scroll. And if we come in on a detail, it's a very large inn. There are, you can see guests, it may be hard to see, guests are having a meal on the second floor, and the first floor, people are here. On the first floor. People are gathered, and some of them are testing out bows and arrows. And one of the things that's interesting about this painting is that it presents a very idealized city. So there's no garbage, there's no crippled people, there's no poverty. There are very few women on the street, and Chinese historians debate whether at the time there were actually that few women on the street. I happen to think there were probably more women outside, but in an ideal Chinese city, women would have been inside because the morals of the time dictated that well-bred women stayed inside. One of the things about this painting that's interesting is that there's very little evidence of foreign presence. And one of the few indicators is here, this is a detail of that inn I just showed you. And on the left-hand side, that character, the Chinese character, is the character Xiang, and it means fragrant or aromatics. And that's a store that is selling the main goods coming into China from the outside, which were fragrant woods, like sandalwood would be the one we're most familiar with, resins like frankincense that you could burn and they would give off a fragrance, and also spices. And so that's one hint of China's trade at this time. This is as when I first came to Yale, I was talking a lot to our then art historian named Richard Barnhart, and he kept saying to me, conversation after conversation, this is not a photograph. And I really didn't understand what he meant. And then later on, I finally understood. This is one person's depiction of what a city looked like the artist distorted things to fit his vision. So we can't use it for evidence of exactly what a city looked like, but it's very suggestive, and it's, I think, very likely that he copied the way buildings looked at the time, and he put in the kinds of shops that existed at the time. And this is the other hint in the scroll of China's foreign trade at the time. So this is a furniture store, and it, I say a little bit in jest that it was like an IKEA, but part of the reason I say it's like an IKEA is that the things it's selling, that it advertises in that sign, are all imported goods. And I mentioned sandalwood. Aloes wood is a wood that I don't think anybody has ever heard of, except for scholars, sometimes called eagle wood or garu wood. But it was the most popular wood that the Chinese were importing from Southeast Asia. And frankincense, as I mentioned, we know from the story of the three kings bringing gifts to the baby Jesus. Frankincense was a resin that, when you lit it, gave off a very pleasant fragrance. So that's to give you a sense of our departure point. We're leaving from Quanzhou. This is a map, so you can see exactly where it is on the Chinese coast. And we're going to travel on the most heavily frequented route in the world from about 800 to 1500 and a little bit after. And so we start at Quanzhou, and then we'll go down. The most popular route was this red route here, or this part of it. This is through the Straits of Malacca. And then most ships actually at this time cross directly to Sri Lanka, and then up the west coast of India. And then here is the Basra, which is the closest port to Baghdad. And there was another route that connected Basra with Sofala on the coast of East Africa. And this was the main shipping route at the time. There was the most traffic, and boats were traveling from Middle Eastern ports all the way to China, and from China all the way to the Middle East. And there were also, of course, mariners who originated their trips in Southeast Asia or in South Asia. The Chinese ships, this is what I said I would like to know about. This is what we know that they were carrying, and we know this mostly from texts, from historical records, but we also know it from some shipwreck evidence. The ceramics we know the most about because they last the longest when they're buried underwater or trapped underwater for 1,000 years. So there were lots of Chinese ceramics. The Chinese were also exporting metal goods like metal ingots of tin and copper, and then also objects that they made, the kinds of things that were for sale in that hardware store on the bridge in the Qingming Scroll. And then, of course, I think we all know about high-quality textiles like silks and cottons. This route, the climate was warm enough that people probably weren't shipping that much silk. It was much more likely that they were shipping cotton. We have a shipwreck. Most of the shipwrecks are from Indonesia because the Sea of Java, the Java Sea, is so shallow. But this is a shipwreck that was found actually very close to Quanzhou, our departure point. And we can see some of the hallmarks of Chinese shipbuilding technology. They built ships of wood and nails, and you can see that the ship was divided into different compartments, and those were watertight so that if one compartment sprang a leak, the rest of the ship would not be affected. And this ship, when it was excavated in the Cultural Revolution, this is a slide of what the archaeologists found. The excavation was in the 1970s. And you can see in the foreground of the slide various objects, which are a little bit hard to make out. So here's a list of what they found, the archaeologists found. And this fits the textual evidence we have that with lots of things that qualify as aromatics. So incense and these woods like sandalwood and aloes wood, black pepper, ambergris, which is an element used in perfume that comes from the intestines of whales, frankincense. Mercury was used probably as a medicine. Turtle shell was decorative, just as we use it today for glasses. The Chinese didn't have glasses in the year 1000, but they had little boxes. And then the last two items were also used in medicine. And this next picture is from an encyclopedia, that very helpful picture of all of the things that were being exported from Southeast Asia to China in exchange for the ceramics and the textiles and the metal goods that the Chinese were exporting. The first leg of the trip, we arrive in Baghdad, and Baghdad was in the year 1000 an enormous city of learning. It was rivaled. Probably the biggest cities in the world were Baghdad, and then the big cities in China. In 1000, Shenzhou does not have a million people yet, but the Chinese capital, Kaifeng, certainly does. And in Baghdad, there were schools, there were libraries, there was an educated elite. And when I say, where else in the world can we say this about? I hope the answer is obvious, that China is the answer. Europe, the universities, the first universities in Europe will be founded around 1200. So the centers of learning in Europe are mostly monasteries. One of the big differences between the Islamic world, or learning in the Islamic world versus learning in China, was that Arabic was a relatively new language. And so there was not a huge corpus, a huge body of texts written in Arabic, the way that there were so many texts written in Chinese. And so Chinese scholars at this time tended to focus on texts written in Chinese. They certainly were very interested in Buddhist texts and looked at a lot of texts from Sanskrit, but they did not translate from other languages. In Baghdad, there was a house of translation and a house of learning that was founded by the second Abbasid caliph, Mansur, and he encouraged translations into Arabic of books that were written in Greek and Latin and Sanskrit. And these are very important in terms of world history, because of course people reading Arabic read and learned about the learning of both ancient India and the classical world of Greece and Rome. But these Arabic translations were also sometimes the basis of translations into Latin that people read in Europe, in the European universities, after that got going in 1200. And one of the reasons that Baghdad could be such a center of learning was that they had the technology for making paper, which had come out of China. And my question here is, I was going to say, you may or may not know that before the people in the Middle East had paper, sometimes they were using papyrus, which they imported from Egypt, but more often they were using animal skin, and which we sometimes call parchment. I think it's a little confusing. They were using animal skins, and that was true in Europe too. And paper was reached the Islamic world from China much earlier than it reached Europe. It's in Baghdad around 800, gets to Europe to Sicily and Spain. So the Islamic portals into Europe around 1100. So, and then I mentioned that some of the people who were traveling at this time were traveling involuntarily. And one of our best sources is a slave buying guide written by, he's actually a Christian doctor living in Baghdad named Ibn Butlan. And he mentions 19 different places that you can buy enslaved people from in the Baghdad slave market. And you can see them on the slide, that slaves are coming, I think most of us would expect this, from Africa, but they're also coming from Northern and Eastern Europe, and also from different places in Asia. And this is something that scholars are working on right now, is trying to understand who were the enslaved people at this time. And most of them were female, and it's because they were female and they worked as household servants, sometimes they were taken as, I was going to say they're forced to have sex with their owners. But if they gave birth to a child fathered by the owner, the children were born free. And Islamic teachings held that the mother of the children should be emancipated at the time of her owner's death, if she hadn't already been emancipated. And there are some examples in Abbasid society of former slave women rising to the very top of society. Kaiseran is a very good example of a woman who starts life as a slave girl, and then she marries a caliph, the head of the Islamic community, and becomes one of the most powerful people in Baghdad. And now, a little bit into the talk, time for the first Q&A.
Fantastic. This will give you a chance to catch your breath and maybe a sip of water. We'll eddy out the boat that we're using to take the trip, and I'll invite our audience and remind them to use the Ask the Professor tab to submit formal questions regarding the first leg of tonight's journey. First question comes from Kevin. Kevin's a teacher in Indiana, and he noted, I'm going to reframe his question a little bit. He noted that in many of the artistic renditions, particularly of the Chinese murals that you shared, that you're right. It was, there's an interpretation there. Can you talk to us a little bit about what factors would have led to or informed that interpretation? Was it gender? Was it class? Was it location and family? What do you think really informed the artist and this documentarian as they captured these images?
Well, it's a great question, and one that, of course, scholars debate. Everybody who looks at the scroll agrees that it shows an idealized society. So then the question is, who was the patron, and who would have wanted a painting showing an idealized society? And most people's answer is that the Chinese emperor would have liked to have a painting showing his realm being at peace and prosperous, and you know, not having anybody suffering from poverty or any handicapped people. And one of the things that's very noticeable about the Qingming scroll is the extent of commerce throughout the scroll, and the painter has a very favorable attitude towards commerce. And that's one of the things that's distinctive about the Song Dynasty, is the dynasty's support for trade. The dynasty was very innovative in how it taxed trade. And so I think all the places I can detect distortion between what I think was the reality of life in a city of over a million people, and the painting, all go back to that question of presenting an idealized city.
Great, thank you so much. This next question comes from John. John is a teacher at Westminster School in Atlanta, and he's wondering if you can speak to this question. How comprehensive is our understanding of manumission on various legs of this journey?
Partial. So I wouldn't say comprehensive. We don't, this is an early period in history. We don't have much information about people in the lower ranks of society. So a book like Ibn Butlan's book is very unusual, and it doesn't tell us anything about manumission, right? And it's filled with stereotypes, often extremely painful to read now, about the characteristics of enslaved people coming from one place or another. So most of our sources about manumission are prescriptive, meaning they're laws or regulations or teachings or sermons about the way that things should work. We don't have very much information that's descriptive about how things actually worked. That's one reason Kaiseran's biography is interesting, because she talks in the there's a very detailed record we have of the Abbasid Caliphate, And it talks about how she meets Mansour, the caliph who purchases her, and what she says to him. When they meet, she doesn't tell him that she has any family. She says she's like a single, unconnected woman. And then after they marry and she produces a son, she reveals that she does have a family, and the caliph summons her family to the palace. So we know a lot more about manumission later than we do in this period.
Thank you. Thank you for the question, John. Maybe the last question before we move on, this comes from Joe. Joe is in Greensboro, North Carolina, and he asks the following. Understanding that you're framing the trade and travel from Far Eastern Asia back to Southwest Asia, how is Constantinople bearing its influence as a center of East meeting West?
Well, I'm not going to say too much about Constantinople, but it's certainly a very important city. Because it's not on this particular sea route that was so heavily traveled, I haven't said that much about it. But Constantinople is one of the cities in the world that we know a fair amount about. And I'll be talking about it a little bit in the next leg. Maybe that's a good way to segue to the next leg.
Perfect segue. Thank you.
So we traveled by boat to get to Basra. And now we're going to travel from Baghdad to Denmark. I should alert all of you that this is the quickest leg of our trip, because I think most of you will know the most about Europe. And this is a map showing the sources of slaves coming into the Islamic world, but also into Constantinople. And we're going to follow those routes and make our way from Baghdad to Denmark. We're going to travel about 3,000 miles. And I was going to say, if you look at records of how quickly people travel, all kinds of people, including armies, most people manage to cover about 20 miles a day. And so it probably would take us about 150 days to go all the way from Baghdad to Denmark. One of the things that's going on in Europe at this time is that Europe's economy is beginning to take off very dramatically. And we can see that in terms of population growth, that the population increases from less than 40 million in the year 1000 to around 75 million in 1340. And you probably know why I picked this arbitrary date of 1340, because in 1348, the Black Death hit, and the population is greatly reduced. And then by 1500, Europe's population begins to recover. And I'm a huge fan of this book by R.I. Moore called The First European Revolution. Even though it's 22 years old, I think it's stood the test of time. And it certainly has profoundly influenced my thinking. One of the things we know about European agriculture, the reason for this increased productivity, is that there are new farm tools that people are using. And R.I. Moore coined this word cerealization, meaning that more of Europe was devoted to planting cereals than it had been, and that leads to a huge increase in the production of grain. And this shows a horse-drawn plow pulling, you can read the caption, pulling a harrow. This is a harrow. And so that when we have a harrowing experience, it's because we feel as though we've been raked over with a harrow. But it was these iron tools were very effective at breaking up the soil and then making it possible to plant seeds evenly and at the same depth, and thus increase agricultural production. And one of the things that historians have realized about Europe at this time is fitting in keeping with that source I was telling you about, the slave buying manual, that Europe was exporting enslaved people to the Islamic world, and they were, people in the Islamic world were buying enslaved people with these Arab dirhams, these silver coins, And we know that because there have been so many hordes of huge, ooh, I misspelled horde, my apologies. No, I spelled it correctly. One of those blind spots I have. But hordes with tens of thousands of coins have been found in, you can see in Scandinavia, also in Eastern Europe. And scholars wondered what they were, why people were burying this silver underground and where the silver, why did they have so many coins coming from the Abbasid world? And that now I think the consensus is pretty secure that people in the Islamic world are buying slaves and furs from Northern and Eastern Europe, and they're buying them with silver coins. And often the people selling the slaves are war band leaders or war bands, and the war band leaders would reward their followers with maybe the coins, but also silver armbands made out of silver melted down from the coins. As you can see in this picture. And we have some documentary evidence of the slave trade. We have some of the sources are in Arabic and talk about the Rus were a group of people who originated in Scandinavia and moved into modern Ukraine and settled there and form ultimately the first big polity in Ukraine. And so we have Ibn Rushd talking about the slave trade. And then Adam of Bremen is a bishop who was stationed in northern Germany. And he talks about the Norse slave dealers and how they would catch their countrymen and sell them into slavery. I told you this was going to be a very short leg of the trip because I think it's the most familiar part of our trip. So we are at a break for Q&A if the audience has any questions.
We do have a couple of questions that have come in. The first one is from Pamela. Pamela is a teacher at St. John Catholic School, I believe in Georgia. Pamela's wondering if you can say a word or so about the impact of the monsoons on this leg of the journey.
The monsoons would have affected the first leg, because the key thing about the winds was that to travel all the way from China to the Islamic world, or even to India, was you had to catch the monsoons in one direction that would take you to going south would take you to Singapore, and then you had to wait there, the modern Singapore. You had to wait there for about 6 months for the winds to shift so you could continue your journey. And people in the year 1000 are very familiar with the monsoons and have figured out exactly how to travel with them. And we think that that knowledge, it's debated how early people really understand the monsoons, but certainly by 400, the Chinese have figured out how to harness the monsoon winds.
Thank you. Next question comes from Bethany. Bethany's in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. She's wondering if you could talk some about communications at this time. Other than movement and other than migration, how were stories shared? How were communications of news and cultures shared?
Well, I think Stephanie's right that most of it is face-to-face. People meet each other and they tell each other things. That of course, there's some letter writing, and we have some letters that were sent and never arrived. We have some letters that were sent and arrived. But those are basically the main modes of communication. And we know, for example, when people are waiting for the monsoons to shift, that they're sitting in port for months at a time. And, stories may be hard to move from one society to another unless you have interpreters. And we know that some stories and some plots are moving from one society to another. Games are much easier. You can teach somebody how to play a game. And so there's a lot of movement of games. Chess is one of the things that originates in India and spreads to Europe, but really all over at this time. And medicine is another thing that spreads, because I think when you're sick in a foreign place and you want to get better, you're willing to take any medicine anyone gives you. And so there's a lot of trade in medicine and medical knowledge.
Fantastic. We've got one more question before we can move on. This comes from Janine, who's in at Red Mountain High School in Mesa, Arizona. And Janine is wondering what the main source of silver was for the Abbasid dirhams.
There are mines. There are mines in the Abbasid Empire, and there are, the coins have mint marks on them, so we know where they were minted. And so there's, I am not someone who knows too much about coins, but there are actually dictionaries that you can look up photographs of coins and examine the mint marks and match them to the coin, whatever coin it is that you're looking at.
Great. I want to be mindful of time. We've got about 35 minutes or so. You know, the questions are tending to cluster in the leg that you are describing. In fact, Pamela's question got a little bit off of the legs, but I'm glad you pulled it back. Let's go with one more. This one's from Ricardo. Ricardo's in Miami, Florida. Here's his question. Is Slav the root of the word slavery? Could you tell us more about the European slave trade at this time?
Slav is the root of the word slave. This is a complicated question that involves languages that I myself don't know, so my account may be a little garbled, but basically the Latin word for slave was sclavus, and that goes back to Rome. And then around like 900, 1000, people start and they switch to a word that's much closer to Slav. And I explain this in my book. And if you sent me an email, I can send you a screenshot of the explanation. But we can see that Greek word meaning Slav displacing the earlier word for slave. And so there are so many slaves coming in from Eastern Europe that being taken from Eastern Europe, mostly to the Islamic world, that becomes the main word. It takes over. So many of the enslaved people are Slavs that the word Slav takes on this broader meaning of slave.
Great. Well, we've got some other questions, Mike. I see yours, and we will bring that forward shortly. But why don't we move to the next leg, and then we can make sure we address these as we continue the journey.
So the next leg of the trip is we're still on firm ground that we know people are traveling on these exact routes. We know when they were traveling. We know what kinds of ships they were traveling in, and this is a map from a world history textbook I write called Voyages in World History. And it shows the routes that the Norse took. Scandinavia, so modern Sweden and Norway and Denmark are the homeland of the Norse. They go first to Iceland in the 870s, and then from Iceland, they go to Greenland. They actually name Greenland around 980, and then around 1000, they take the sea route and end up at, you can see this on the map, in a place called Lanthaw Meadows, which is in Newfoundland, the maritime province of Canada. And in terms of the timing, this is the shortest leg, and I get the time from this voyage of a replica Viking ship that crossed on this route, and you can see the days that when it leaves Norway and when it arrives in Newfoundland. Here's a picture of Lanthaw Meadows, and I recommend that a trip to Lanthaw Meadows. It's a beautiful place. It's a long, long drive. When you look at I've driven there from Connecticut. When you look at the map, you don't really understand the distances that are involved. But there are oral sagas in Old Norse or in Old Icelandic describing voyages to a place called Vinland. And people suspected that people weren't sure where Vinland was. Before the discovery of Lanthal Meadows, a lot of people thought that Vinland might be around Boston or about Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard. And if you go for a run on the Charles River, you can see some plaques telling you your location is the historic Vinland, which is we now know not to be true. But in the 1961, a Norwegian archaeologist named Anne Stein and her husband traveled along the coast of the Canadian coast looking for Viking sites. And when they got to this town of Lanthal Meadows, they asked the locals if there were any places where anything that looked like a Norse site. And the locals took them to some collapsed houses that unfortunately they didn't take pictures of at the time, but some collapsed houses made of sod. And then the Ingstads excavated there. So it's Anstein Ingstad. The Ingstads excavated there and for 7 summers. And then on the last summer, the last day of digging is always like that with archaeology, they found this pin. And it's a pin that was used to fasten the neck of a cloak. There was a ring. So the pin went through 2 points on a ring, and that's what kept the cloth around your neck. And that pin looks exactly like pins that were found in Denmark and Iceland between about 950 and 1020. So that, and there was other evidence that was incontrovertibly Norse, that the local peoples, the First Nations who live there at this time, were not working. They didn't have bronze. They weren't working copper in this way. This was incontrovertible proof of the Norse presence. And you may have read about this past year, that there was a discovery, a redating of these wooden artifacts from Lanthal Meadows that dendrochronologists from the University of Groningen in Denmark examined the tree rings on a couple of pieces of wood that had been cut down that were found at the Lanthal Meadows site in the layers dating to the Norse occupation. And they realized that one of the tree rings was unusually wide, and they were able to identify that as the tree ring from 993. That's because of increased solar activity. And so they were able to pin down the date that the tree was felled to 1021. Now, we don't know exactly when the Vikings arrived. It's great that it was exactly 1,000 years ago. But we don't know when the Vikings arrived and when they left, but we do know they were there for about a decade. So this gives us a much more precise dating than we had before. It's not too different, because we always thought that they arrived around 1000. And I'm not going to stop for questions, because I'm going to keep going with the Norse voyages and say that, so that part that I told you about, there's no doubt among serious scholars about that, the trip so far, legs 1, 2, and 3. In leg 4, we start to move into the realm of speculation. And one of the questions that I ask in the book is about how far south the Vikings went, and whether it's possible that they went to this area in purple on the map, to the Maya lands. And if they did go, whether they went overland or they went by sea. And it's possible that they were blown off course, because you can see, this is a map showing the main currents, they're called gyres, that are moving around in the Atlantic. And the blue current is deep under the ocean's level. The red current is on the surface of the water. And the you can see that the red current touches, it's moving around the center of the Atlantic Ocean and then touches the tip of the Yucatan Peninsula. So, and we know that people are ships or sailing boats like the Vikings had were caught in storms and blown across huge distances. There's an account in the 19th century of some Japanese sailors who were on a very local voyage from Nagoya to Tokyo, and they were blown all the way across the Pacific to Washington State. So people covered huge distances in these storms when they were blown off course. And the Yucatan Peninsula at this time is the site of the largest city in the Mayan world, and it's called Chichen Itza, and it's about, my label's moved a little bit. The city's about halfway on the northern edge of the Yucatan Peninsula. And so we're still asking the question about whether the Vikings might have traveled this far south. The city had about 40,000 people, and this is a building called the Temple of Warriors. And inside the Temple of Warriors, a group of researchers who were working there in the 1920s and 30s from the Carnegie Institution found some murals. These are fragments of murals that they found that were disintegrating, and these were pieces that were on the floor. And then, unfortunately, this is a photograph of the original mural. It's a photograph of a copy made by an artist named Anne Axtell Morris, who was married to the lead excavator on the site. And there are these two very, there are other images, but these I think are the most indicative of these. We have here clearly someone who's been caught. He's a captive. You can see he's in the water. He's got very long yellow hair. It has blue beads in it, and that is a motif in Mayan art indicating a POW. And then you can see a hand is holding him, his hair above his head. And then there's another picture of another blonde-haired person whose arms are behind him and who's in the water. And so one of the things that I was interested in is the possibility that these might have been Norse people shown in these murals. I have to say, I was very surprised by the reaction to this when in writing about it in the book, that people act as though, I'm going to say that this is just completely impossible, that, I'm proposing that the Martians built the Great Wall or something like that. And I think the contrast with Lancel Meadows is interesting, because before the Ingstads found the pin at Lancel Meadows, it was also speculation about whether the Norse had, where they had been, and whether they had been anywhere in New Finland. There's more evidence. So this, some people find this evidence, I think the evidence is interesting. I think it'd be for teaching. It'd be fun to show the students and ask them what they think. You could easily dismiss the evidence and say that these people don't, it's not pictures of people with blonde hair. It's people who are shown having yellow hair. So it's a little bit like the Qingming scroll. It's not a photograph, right? It's a piece of art, but it certainly fits with the possibility that some Norse were blown off course, landed in Yucatan, and were taken prisoner. There's some other evidence that may be more persuasive. This is a picture from a different building the Temple of the Warriors was built around 1000, so the timing is perfect for when the Norse were in North America and they might have been blown to the Yucatan. This is a picture of a boat, and what's the main piece of what's interesting about this picture is that It shows, you have to look very closely at it, but you can see individual planking on the boat. And the Maya had dug out canoes. And so this appears to be a technology, a boat made with different technology than the Maya used. And this, just to remind you, is what a Viking ship looked like. This is a little earlier. This one is from 820. But you can see the very distinctive planking. It looks as though each of the planks runs the whole length of the boat, but that's not true. They're just joined. There are different pieces of wood that are joined together to give that appearance of one long piece of wood. So that's one possibility, is that the Vikings might have traveled and been blown off course and ended up at the Yucatan. There's another possibility that they traveled overland, and this possibility, I think, is more interesting, not necessarily that the Norse used these overland routes, but that we should just realize that there was extensive trade among the different settlements in North America. And you can, and I do this in my book, explain that archaeologists have found goods from one location in another site, distinctive goods, and I'll show you some slides explaining what I mean, and on that basis have reconstructed trade routes. And so this is a view of the a building at the first building you see when you go to Chichen Itza, and it's an architectural marvel because at the equinox, the shadow on the side of these two staircases, there's a staircase like this on each of the four sides, the shadow undulates like a dragon. You can look at it on YouTube. It's quite beautiful. But at Chichen Itza, there are these, all over the Yucatan Peninsula, are these pools of water called cenotes. And the one at Chichen Itza contained a lot of, it was a ritual site. And there were skeletons that were recovered from the cenote that had been cut apart, probably sacrificial victims. And then there were also a number of artifacts that were found. And archaeologists have looked at these and reconstructed the trade between the Maya and different societies around them. And like one of the finds is that turquoise was an export from New Mexico that the Maya were bringing in. And we've got the site, well, New Mexico, but the whole New Mexico and Utah, that this is the site of Chaco Canyon. And these are vessels. So this is in New Mexico, that these vessels on the left are typical Chaco Canyon vessels, and they were found with chocolate, the remains of chocolate. It's called theobromine was found in the bottom of these vessels. And the only people who were making chocolate at this time were the Maya. So archaeologists have been able to demonstrate that there was a trade between the Maya were trading chocolate and also beautifully, brightly colored feathered macaw birds for the turquoise coming from New Mexico. There may have been other trade goods, but the things that don't survive in an archaeological context don't survive, so we don't know about them. It's unusual that the feathers survive and tell us about that. And we also know that the people in Chichen Itza were trading with societies to the south, with in modern-day Panama and Colombia, because there were these metal goods were found, these gold figurines were found in the cenote. So this is the time for Q&A, and I would just say this is the realm of speculation, but I think one of the most interesting things about teaching history is asking the students how we know the things we know and how secure we are in our knowledge. And when I was teaching this history, I to an introductory history class to first year students, I gave them a true-false test where the students had to tell me if something was definitely true, if it was a fact, if it was likely, if it was possible, or if it was definitely not true. And we had a lot of fun in that unit, and I would recommend it to you in your teaching. So, okay, break time.
Great. Thank you for that suggestion. And I'm seeing just wonderful conversation between our audience members about these kinds of collaborations and interdisciplinary activities as well. This question comes from Pedro. Pedro is joining us from Los Angeles tonight. He asks, are there any possible routes to the Americas from Africa and Polynesia at this time?
Those are great questions. This is something I'm interested in now, and I wrote a little bit about in the book. I wrote a lot about Polynesia, and that'll be in the fifth leg of the trip. It'll go very fast. But I'll talk about the debate whether or not people traveled all the way from Polynesia to the west coast to Ecuador. Africa's also a possibility, and I just mentioned one route that in the book that there's a. When the Spanish arrived in the on the Yucatan Peninsula, they visited a town, and it was named for people who had come from. They said this. I mean, the Spanish version is that Moors had been shipwrecked and come there. And so I talked about that possibility. That there's no reason that people couldn't have traveled from Africa to the Americas. We have even less evidence of that than we do of the Norse travels, but it's something that I'm interested in. And it turns out there are some Arabic sources about boats in Africa a little bit later that I didn't know about when I was writing the book. So I'm working on it. Thank you very much for the question. I think it's a very good question.
Yeah, thanks. You've mentioned several times tonight this notion of speculation and debate of evidence and being able to articulate a clear argument, including the one that you shared about the Vikings potentially visiting the Yucatan Peninsula. This question comes from Monica. Monica's in Brooklyn, New York, and she wonders if there's a single controversy right now in the scholarly realm that you're aware of. What is the big controversy right now in this topic in your world?
Well, I'm going to talk about. I mean, this talk is covering such a huge amount of territory. So there are lots of things are being debated. That's one of the great things, right, about scholarship, that in every field there are debates. But the final leg, I'll be talking about this debate about the possibility of travel between the west coast of South America and Easter Island. And I would say, not just one debate, but I think the whole field is debating the use of DNA evidence and how to use it and how we can interpret it. That the I was reading something that over the summer about, you know, if you just had DNA evidence, like DNA samples from the American population, you would be able to say that the current American population had some indigenous roots, but it also had a portion from Europe and a portion from Africa. But you wouldn't know that people from Europe came mostly voluntarily and people from Africa came mostly involuntarily. And so I think that's the debate, is figuring out what information we can get from DNA and then how we can combine it with history to give the most accurate and the most responsible description of the past.
Yeah, that's a fantastic answer. Thank you. One more question. This comes from Joe. Again, Joe is in Greensboro. Just wondering what the current level of research is, active effort, he means, to connect the Norse people to Mesoamerican civilizations, or is it still mostly speculative?
I would say there's very few people working on this. I had one of my colleagues at Yale died a couple of years ago, very sadly, and helped me a great deal, a man named Michael Coe, who was a great historian of the Maya and of all of the peoples of Mexico. And he was very interested in this theory, as was another former colleague of mine named Mary Miller. And then one of my co-students is interested in this, but this is not a topic that is getting much attention from most of the people working on the Maya.
Right. Professor, we have about 15 minutes left, so let's enter our next leg.
And when you say that, should I talk for 15 minutes or should I leave Q&A at the end?
You know what? I would work through the content that you develop. We're here to hear the story that you're sharing. We probably want to start winding up around 8:27 or so East Coast time, so we can take maybe one or two final questions. But I want to give you as much time as we can.
I like the specificity. One time, my family we were racing for a train in Italy, and my mother was just beside herself that we were going to miss the train. And as we were running along the platform, this conductor said in English, very, very kindly, he said, "Take your time. You have a minute."
You have 1 minute. That's right. I'll give you that heads up when you have 1 minute. Thank you.
Yeah, I actually think this is going to work. We'll see how this goes time-wise. So here's the debate. I think depending on your age, you may be familiar with Thor Heyerdahl's route. Many people who are, I don't know, I would say over 50 are very familiar with this. Thor Heyerdahl proposed that you could travel, and historically, that people traveled taking this route that I show you on the map. And his ship was called Kon-Tiki. And I'm sorry, I should know the year that he did this. I wonder if it's on my slide and I can't see it. But anyway, I'm guessing this was in the late 40s, the early 50s. Anyway, this was a very famous voyage. And basically, and there's a movie about this, and he was quite famous. I think most scholars think this is not true, this direction of travel that he proposed. And he traveled in this raft, this reconstructed raft called Kon-Tiki. But what people forget is that he had to be pulled out into the ocean something like 200 miles before Kon-Tiki took over and was able to sail to Easter Island. And so this has to do with answering this question goes back to the gyres and the movement of water and understanding the ocean currents. And this is something I think we're going to see more of in the next decade. It goes back to that excellent question about voyaging from Africa to the Americas. But the gyres, and this is what the gyres look like now, but historically, I think they differed because there were, the climate was a little bit different. But it was very hard. This is where the Humboldt Current is. It was very hard to sail. This arrow makes it like it should be easy to sail from the west coast of Latin America, of South America, to sail in a westerly direction. It's actually very hard to get away from the coast, far enough away that you could get into the Pacific. And so we have the possibility that of travel originating in South America and going towards Easter Island. We also have the opposite possibility that people at Easter Island traveled to South America. And this is an example of the kinds of controversies that are going on right now. This was so in Nature in 2020, a study appeared that was looked at people who were living in Polynesia and then also some indigenous Americans the DNA is people who are living in South America, but they don't, and they have some Polynesian blood, they have some indigenous DNA, but they have none from Europeans. So that suggested to the investigators that people had traveled before the arrival of the Europeans in the Americas after 1492, that there had been contact between Ecuador and the Polynesian Islands. But there were a lot of criticisms, and I give you the source of both of these things because this is a fun debate to read with your students, and these two scholars think that the investigators were misreading their data, and that what they interpreted as being DNA from one group of people or another group of people wasn't accurate. But they also said, and this part makes sense to me as a historian, that if you really wanted to show this, you need to look at skeletons from before 1492. And that, because if you are looking at modern people and their DNA, you don't know when people mixed. Like, it's possible people from Easter Island mixed with people in South America after 1492. So, and that's, I think, one of the things that historians are wrestling with right now. Now, going back to the question about Polynesian voyages, these are the voyages that we do know about for sure. There's no question about these voyages, that the chronology may be a little bit debatable, but not the actual voyages. We know that the Polynesians there were three legs of a trip originating in Samoa, and then in the Society Islands, going towards Easter Island, to the east, to the north to Hawaii, and then to the southwest to New Zealand. And this is based on finding artifacts that are all diagnostic artifacts from Polynesian culture. And also, all of these islands were not previously settled. So this is when, these are the dates of the first human occupation on these islands. Here is the reference for this research that proposes these different waves of migration. We're not sure. There's no archaeological evidence of what boats looked like. We know that boats looked like this when the Polynesians first encountered Europeans, that there were two canoes that were lashed together and they had a sail. We don't know what, and this is in on the left is James Cook, the late 1700s. The one on the right is earlier. So there are debates about what the boats look like. But I was going to say, one thing we know is, and this is modern evidence, very interesting evidence, this man now dead, named Malpiolog, had studied the traditional Polynesian method of navigating, and with the elders, he was the last person to be initiated as a navigator. Here he's teaching this star map to his son and another boy. And when the Polynesian navigators were traveling through the Pacific, they had memorized the configuration of stars in many different possible skies. So they knew like times of year and locations in the Pacific. And we know how well the system worked because Mao was able to navigate. He had never traveled there before. He traveled all the way from Tahiti to Hawaii, and this was to commemorate in 1976. And so his ability to do that showed how powerful this Polynesian navigation system was. I was going to say that as far as we know, the Polynesians get to Easter Island, but we don't know that they get past Easter Island. If there was contact between Easter Island and the west coast of South America, my money is on the Polynesians because they are a voyaging people and they have, we know how far they traveled around the Pacific. It's not on the people on the west coast of South America, the Ecuadorians, because they may have had rafts, but they are not known as a sailing people. Okay, the conclusion. Our trip took us actually probably a little more than 2 years using the means of transport that existed in the world in the year 1000. And I won't recap, I'll just say, remind you that the fourth and fifth legs are highly tentative and very debated. The big difference, I think the closing is that in the year 1000, no one is traveling all the way around the world. Regions are being connected for the first time. And if you travel from one regional pathway to another, you can go all the way around the world. And I include this slide of these beads, these blue glass beads were found in Alaska in 2021. And they're a good example of, they traveled all the way from Italy across Asia, across the Bering Straits into Alaska. So it's a good example of the kinds of trade routes that, the trade that was taking place before Columbus. When we think about 1500 and the famous voyages of Columbus and Da Gama and Magellan, it is true that they are the first people, Magellan is the first, not Magellan because he's killed by his crew, but Magellan's ship is the first to circumnavigate the world. But I think it's very important to remember that they are building on the accomplishments of people who lived about 500 years earlier. And so in the specific case of Da Gama, that when he's traveling down the west coast of Africa, that he is pioneering a new route. As far as we know, the indigenous peoples of Africa were not sailing on these routes on the west coast of Africa. But as soon as he crosses the Cape of Good Hope, and once he gets up to Mombasa, so the port facing Madagascar on the east coast of Africa, he then is connecting with that route that I began my talk with when I told you it was the most heavily traveled route before 1500, that up the coast of East Africa to Baghdad, and then from Baghdad to China. And so I think let us end there. That's the key thing I'd like you all to think about, is how important, what was going on, the developments before 1500, and how important they are. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Professor. We do have time for a couple of questions. Again, if anyone in the audience has a formal question you'd like me to bring forward in the remaining moments, I'd be happy to do so. I wonder, Professor, if you can, now that we've done some time traveling, I wonder if you can return us to the if not the present, at least future years from the year 1000. How, in your opinion, does the map, and by map I mean the journey and the connections and the evidence-based ways that these cultures are mingling and interacting. In your opinion, how does this lead to what we now call globalization?
Oh, because it's the first time, I think, that so many people are affected by contact with other places. And so people in many parts of the world are exposed to goods coming from other places, to people coming from other places, to ideas. This is a period when there's enormous religious change in Afro-Eurasia. And to me, the bottom line about globalization is that you're producing for a market that you can't see and you can't control. And that was true of the Chinese, that they were exporting to, their ceramics have been found in Southeast Asia, India, the Islamic world, East Africa. But the opposite was also true, that people in Southeast Asian forests were killing brightly colored kingfisher birds for export to China. They had no idea who they were selling them to. And so I think it's the first time that so many people around the world are affected by these broader economic currents. And I was going to say, one of the really interesting things is that, and sad things, is we have anti-globalization riots very early on. There's a riot in Cairo in 996 where the locals rise up against Italian merchants who they think are making more money than they should. And something similar to that happens in Constantinople about two centuries later in the massacre of the Latins.
Professor, you've given us a lot to think about. We're exhausted from the trip and inspired. Thank you so much for leading us on this journey. Thank you, Professor Hansen.
It was my pleasure. Thank you all.
And I want to thank our entire audience for joining us for tonight's session. Please do follow the National Humanities Center on our social media feeds, especially Twitter, and see upcoming events and activities. Don't forget to check the digital library for a recording of tonight's session, which will include edited topical sections of the talk that you can share with your students, either as prompts or perhaps as formative assessments and allow Professor Hansen herself to describe some of these wonderful images. I'll also be adding the PowerPoint to the resource deck in the digital library momentarily. I hope to see you at a future webinar that might be the next one. February 1st, I'll be joined by Jean Theo Harris from Brooklyn College. She'll be working with us on the rebellious life of Rosa Parks. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for this webinar. I hope you have a great day at school tomorrow, and we'll see you next time in the Humanities in Class webinar series. Good night, everyone.
And when